following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
Gnostic Mysteries, The Serpents of Eden. We are going to penetrate into the mystery of the world of Eden and the mystery of the word. You know, as you see there in the first graphic that we are presenting in this lecture, we find Hermes Trismegistus, which is, of course, the messenger of the god Mercury. Mercury is always associated with the word, with wisdom. That's why Hermes is called the wise. And he is always associated with the caduceus of Mercury. So we are going to penetrate into the mysteries of Kabbalah and alchemy related with the serpents of Hermes, associated with our psychosomatic system in each one of us. First, let us read what the Master Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew, Chapter 10, verse 16, chapter 12, verse 40, where we read, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents, and harmless as a dove." Behold that we put in between the word Jonah, which in Hebrew means dove, and that is written with Yod, Vav, Nun, Hey. In the following verse, we read, "For as Jonah," again we find in between the meaning of dove in Hebrew, "was 3 days and three nights in the big fish belly, because this is precisely the translation in Hebrew as well as in Greek, big fish. And we find between brackets, final nun. Remember that the letter nun symbolizes in Aramaic, or means in Aramaic, fish. So the letter nun is at the very end of the word Jonah. Or better said, is the third letter in the word Jonah in Hebrew. But when we write final nun, we write that as a straight line from the head to the feet at the end of any word in Hebrew. And also, obviously, it becomes big, stretches. That's why we find, or we wrote, final nun for big fish. Because nun means fish. Small is the normal nun, and the bigger nun is big fish. It's related, of course. If you associate that with alchemy and Kabbalah in relation with the words and letters written in Hebrew, then you find the wisdom hidden within those verses that usually we read in the Gospels. Because Master Jesus says, for as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the big fish's belly, so shall the Son of Man, which he symbolizes in Kabbalah, Tifereth, and symbolized by the letter Vav, be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And the earth is symbolized in Kabbalah by the letter He of the holy name of God, Yod He Vav He. So behold there how the whole wisdom of Kabbalah is hidden for those that have eyes to see and to comprehend the mystery of alchemy, which now we are unveiling for humanity, because humanity needs it. So remember that Mercury is associated with the water, Mem. And we find also in the Bible, in the book of Genesis, the next graphic, that is, of course, the graphic of Quetzalcoatl, which in Nahuatl language means the feathered serpent, which is we are associating as well with the serpent and the dove. Because when you imagine a dove, you imagine a bird with wings. So it's the same symbol, but in another language. And in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, we read, Vav, the serpent, was wiser than any beast of the field which Yod-Havah Elohim had made. Behold here as well the word Asya, written before made, because the word Asya relates to the world of action and matter and is associated with the letter He, Malkut. So this is how, when you enter into the mysteries of Kabbalah and alchemy, you read the book of Genesis and the Gospels associated with that mystery of the tree of life and the tree of good and evil. So the letter Vav itself is the serpent that we are talking about. But we are going to point at you how the symbol of the serpent is hidden within the anatomy of the human being in his own psychosomatic system in relation with the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Remember that the letter Vav means "and" in Hebrew. Also, when you said in Spanish "and," you said only "e," the sound "e," which is the letter Vav. So this Vav is a very symbol of the serpent, hidden from the beginning of the book of Genesis. We find that this letter Vav appears for the first time in the first verse of the book of Genesis when we read, Bereshit bara Elohim at hashamayim Vav at haaretz, which means in English, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. So here we find that the letter Vav is associated with the earth, with matter in action, as we were pointing you the word Asiya, which means made in Hebrew. It means that the action of the Holy Spirit in the matter is done through the serpent. We will say there, in the beginning God created the heaven, Vav, which means the serpent, the earth. But we read in Hebrew, Ve'at. And in other lectures, we already explained that the letter Aleph and the letter Tav, which makes that word At, symbolizes the word. Because Aleph is the first letter and Tav is the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The same as when we heard in Greek, Alpha and Omega. And remember that Alpha and Omega is associated with Christ, because he himself said, I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, referring to the power of the word. That's why Christ, the second Logos, is called the Logos, the Word, which in the book of John states in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But here, let us read a quotation from the Zohar in order to get into it deeper for us to comprehend. The Zohar states, a great fish, we put between brackets, letter nun final, in order for you to see, coming from the left, swims through all these waterways to poison and corrupt them. Its scales are as steel. From its mouth comes forth a lurid flame, and its tongue is like a sharp sword. Its object is to force its way into the sanctuary of the great ocean, to pollute and defile it, and thus extinguish light, and causing the waters to become frozen, and the great circulatory water system may cease to operate. Of course, you might wonder, what is that? Let me tell you in simple words, but I want to explain, that this great circulatory water system is related to our central nervous system that many times we talked. That the brain and the spinal medulla floats in the cerebral spinal fluid, which is that water. And the other water, this water system, is the creative sexual energy that we have in our genitalia. That is, so put your mind in that in order to comprehend what the Zohar is stating. That's why we put the two serpents, Pingala and Ida. Obviously, here, the Zohar is pointing at Ida, which is the left. The left great fish that is coming, obviously, from the bottom. The Zohar continues. The occult meaning of this mystery is expressed in the words of Scripture. Now, the serpent was wiser than any beast of the field which Yod-Havah Elohim had made. Of course, this is a translation. But the real translation that we made is Vav, the serpent, was wiser than any beast of the field which Yod-Havah Elohim had made, that we saw in the previous graphic. Let me tell you, in order for you to comprehend more of this lecture, in this lecture, that beasts, any beasts, I mean, is written in Hebrew, hayot. In Hebrew, in order to point to life related with the higher levels of his spirituality, you said Haim. Het, Yod, Mem, or double Yod, Mem, Haim. But there is another word that begins with Het, Yod, and ends with Tav, which is Hayot, and is translated as beasts, because it's related to the sexual waters in Yesod, which are always feminine. So Haim is above, we will say, in the waters of our cerebral spinal fluid. And Hayot in the sexual force of Yesod, or the waters of Yesod. So when we read that the Vav, the serpent, was wiser than any beast, and then we read Hayot, then we said, oh, it's addressing the life, but below, in the sexual organs, because Haya means life. It's not addressing Chaim, which is above. So the serpent that is related with procreation is Ida, or what the book of Genesis called evil. The left side of the tree of life. The Zohar states, this Ida, or evil serpent, wished to accomplish his aim by first corrupting the brooklets below in Yesod and making them impure and bitter, so that flowing back to the great ocean, their fountainhead, it might become polluted. This is why he first seduced Adam and brought death into the world and entered into the heart of Adam from the left side. Here, like in many other lectures, we state Adam is the brain. But Adam is always symbolized in different ways. So when we said the great ocean, we have to understand that in Taoism, the brain, Adam, is called the Sea of Marrow. So this sea of marrow, that is our brain, receives the forces of the two serpents, Pingala and Ida. The Zohar continues. There is, however, another serpent that comes from the right. These two serpents, Pingala and Ida, are they that are closely attached to Shushumna, which is Adam. But remember that Adam is the brain, and the channel of Shushumna is connected, the brain, with the spinal medulla in Sanskrit. During his lifetime, as the scripture saith, of all beasts of the field that Yahweh Elohim had made. You see, all the hayot, all the life forces that are in the field, which is Yesod, that Yahweh Elohim, Bina, the Holy Spirit, had made. These two are the most cunning, crafty, and subtle in tempting and destroying Adam, the brain. Woe unto him, the initiate, who allows himself to be led on and seduced by the serpent, for death irretrievable is his doom, physically, morally, and spiritually, both to himself and to those associated with him, as in the case of Adam, who wished to know and become expert in nature's secrets and occult science, in revealing them and exciting within him a fictitious joy and happiness. The serpent acquired that influence and control over Adam, the brain, that contribute to and brought his ruin and downfall, and thus caused him to suffer, as also his successors, from the day that Israel came to the foot, Yesod, of Mount Sinai. The impurity and corruption brought by the serpent was not disappeared from the world. Malkut. So remember that when we address Adam, we also address Israel. Because the two forces, the two serpents, Pingala and Ida, as you know, go into the brain and descend into the nostrils, and from there they go into the heart, which is Tiferet, where we find Israel. So here's where you find, in the next lecture, I mean the next graphic, these three letters that are attached to each other. The letter Yod, the letter Vav, and the letter Nun final. The letter Yod in alchemy, Kabbalah, is the brain. And the little thing that stretches out of that Yod is the spinal medulla, that when it stretches longer, becomes the letter Vav, which touches the heart. Because when we address the heart, Tifereth, in the middle column of the Tree of Life, we are addressing the letter Vav. That's why when you said Yod, the head, Vav, the heart, and then you descend into the big fish, the final Nun, stretch. They are directly into Yesod, and that is final Nun. In other words, we are looking at Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in these three letters. Father is Yod, you know, represented by Keter. The Son, the kingdom of the Son, is in the heart, which is Vav, Tifereth. And the kingdom of the Holy Spirit is Nun, the fish, in the sexual organs, because there is where we find the two polarities, the two fish, the sperm and the ovum, or the two forces divided. And that's why it is very significant that the word yonah, which means dove in Hebrew, relates to these three letters, with the only difference that it has a hey at the end. And that hey symbolizes the physicality of each one of us. But visualize these three letters in the central or middle column of the tree of life, which is your spinal column. This is how you had to see it in order to study this, that Master Jesus says, as Yonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the womb in the spinal medulla. So the Son of Man should be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the big fish. And he's pointing at Yesod. As you see there, the letter Vav, or the letter final Nun, is pointing at the graphic of this woman in profile from the head to the sex. Because the letter Nun, fish, is dual, two positives, forces. In English, for instance, if we translate this Yod, Vav, Nun, we read ion. And you know what is an ion? An ion in chemistry is an atom, which is charged with either positive or negative energy. In other words, an ion could be positive or could be negative. In other words, an ion could be a man or could be a woman, male or female. And in order to balance those ions, positive and negative, man and woman, when we unite them sexually, and then we have yonah. We are in the belly of the whale or the big fish. Because through the sexual organ, which is nun, is how we connect it. And this is yonah to be in the belly of the big fish. That's the alchemical symbol. This is how you see it when you know alchemy. Otherwise, you enter into suppositions of thinking that a big whale and somebody being swallowed and going into the ocean and being vomited in Nineveh. All of that is alchemy. We talk about that in other lectures. But see how you see it there easily? We are pointing, of course, in the right below those ion. That ion. That's why you find the sparkling letters there. Yod, Vav, final Nun, ion, which is positive or negative charged atoms. In the bottom of our personality, our individuality, we are just atoms. We are dealing with solar and lunar atoms. We will say a positive ion is the sun. A negative ion is the moon. That needs to balance with the other. That's why we were divided. But obviously, before being divided into male-female, Adam and Eve, we were androgynous. And this is something that we had to study. Let us look at the next graphic and see the spinal medulla, the brain of the central nervous system, in the very bottom right. And then you see there, in the left, the word yonah. If you understand that the brain is the head, that the medulla is the vav, and the nun is the sexual force in hey, the body, then you understand what Jonah means in alchemy. With this, we are not stating that the prophet Jonah didn't exist. He existed, of course. But the whole mystery, when you read the book, which is very small, says a lot when you know the mystery of the letters of the Hebrew alphabet and how the wisdom is hidden within them. So this is Jonah, as you see there, in the very bottom. Somebody that has united positive and negative, Idap in Gala, in himself, and has awakened the neutral force that in Sanskrit is called Kundalini, or the force of Shekinah in Kabbalah. So, the symbolism of Adam, says the Zohar. Let us read. And Jehovah Elohim formed Adam. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. Jehovah Elohim is always translated as the Lord God. That is, by gathering all the archetypes of Israel. It is one mystery to create, that in Hebrew is Bria. That creation is related with the world of Asia, as we see in the beginning. But to form Adam is another thing. When you read the Bible and you read and Jehovah Elohim formed Adam, people think that he's repeating what we read in the first chapter. No. This is another step. First is to create and then to form, to model that Adam within each one of us. That's why when you read the first chapter of the book of Genesis, every single verse begins in this. And Elohim said, and Elohim said, and Elohim said. The letter Vav is always there. We will say, Vav, the Elohim said. Now let us explain how Vav the Elohim said. In other words, the serpent. Vav is the one that is doing the whole work of Elohim. But if you don't know who Elohim is, alchemically speaking, you don't know what you're reading. To begin, the word El means God. In Hebrew, is Aleph Lamed. If you look at the letter Aleph, you will see that is made by two yods, up and below. And these two yods, up and below, are cut, divided by a letter Nun. This is how you see it. They are united, of course, to the letter Vav, right? This means the two waters that we have above and below in our organism are united by our spinal column. And that is Aleph, which is the letter related with Ayin, Ein Sof Or. You see, Or, light, begins with that Aleph. Because everything that we have to perform in ourselves is in the spinal column with the two waters. Now, that's why the name of God in Hebrew begins with Aleph. Ah, but it's read Eh, El. El means God, masculine. The letter Lamed, the letter L of L, connects the breath of God with the heart. L. But goddess is Aleph Lamed Hey Ella, is how you say it. So God is El, and Ella is goddess. But at the end of the word Elohim, we find the letter Yod and the letter Mem. That in Hebrew means water, ocean, lake. So we read God, goddess, water, or waters, because that I'm also means plural. Yam. El Ella Yam. And we talk about that in other lectures. So where is this? El Ella Yam. In us. We know that El is a force, the positive force related with the brain. That's El. And the feminine force, the goddess, is Ella. And you have to descend the force to the hay, which is also symbolized in alchemy by the sexual organ, which is feminine. Ella. So El and Ella united in the fluids of the cerebral and spinal fluid and sexual fluids, those fluids united is Ella and Elohim in us. So when people are looking for Elohim, or what we say in English, for God outside, he said, they don't know that this Ella Elohim, they are carrying it in their spinal column. But because they don't know that, they are corrupting their brain, their heart, and their sex. Young. They are polarized, or they are charged, positive or negative. But they never balance the forces because they don't know how, alchemically speaking. So that's the Elohim in each one of us. So when you read in the book of Zohar or any book of alchemy about Elohim, you have to ask yourself, you have to look at yourself. El Ela, my spinal column, all my central nervous system. But I have two branches there in that central nervous system that is called grand sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system, right and left. Those are the branches of Israel, which are connected to the different organs in our organism. So God is that energy, that force, that are related with three valves. That's why the tree of life has three columns. The central, the left, and the right. That's how you have to see it. And you always we point that this tree of life, Chaim, Otz Chaim, is in the back, the spinal column, related with the nervous systems, is related with the forces of Yod Havah Elohim. Let us continue what the Zohar states. Hear the word Vav Yetzirah, Vav form. This is the beginning of the word of that Genesis 2:7. Ve Yetzirah, Vav form, is written with two yods or eyes, indicating that the Holy One formed him with two natures, the higher and the lower self, the one divine, the other earthly, and impressed upon his form in Yetzirah the divine name. You see, this is how is written, the word Yetzirah or Yetzer in that verse. But you find two yods and one vav. When you take those yods and put it in each side of the letter vav, then you understand they're talking about the duality. So IVI expressed by the two eyes, two yods, and the nose, the vav, between them. Thus, the numerical value of the letters yod, vav, yod is 26, which is also the numerical value of the name yod, he, vav, he. It is on this account that a scripture saith, from the top of the rocks I shall see him. The word zurim, rocks, denotes also forms, or yetzira. So that Balaam, who uttered these words, meant that in viewing the form of Israel, he beheld and recognized the divine name. This Israel is precisely what any initiate, when the initiate enters into the world of Yetzirah, which in Gnostic terms we will say the second mountain, is when the initiate, who represents Adam, has to do the work through Vav in order to unite all the parts of Israel. All the parts of Adam who are dispersed into the ego. And his duty is to comprehend and annihilate and to unite all the parts. Balaam, of course, is here symbolized by the opposition. That makes us trouble to do it, which is the ego. Another comparison of Israel, Tifereth, with this divine name is in the two tablets of stone contain the law and representing the two yods. The letter Vav symbolizing what is written on them. Man also in himself represents the union and blending together of the higher and lower Shekinahs, symbolized by the repeating of the Shema, morning and evening. A prayer that is always performed by those Orthodox Jews in the morning and the evening. When you read that there, morning and the evening, you understand that the book of Genesis and the evening and the morning was one day. Because as we explain this alchemically speaking, we are seeing that with the union of the two ions, positive and negative, they make the balance. Because the woman is Ida, or representing Ida in this moment of the sexual act, and the man, Pingala. United in the sexual act, they awake the neutral force, which is the Kundalini, which balance the two opposites, the two tablets of the law. Because the man is one tablet and the woman is the other tablet, the two yods. And what is written in them is the letter Vav, their spinal column, the two forces. Those two ions united make a perfect balanced atom or microcosmos. That's why it says higher and lower Shekinahs. Later we will say with the man and the woman, forces of Kundalini. The Zohar continues. The union of the two natures in Adam is also referred to in the words, bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. Genesis 2, verse 23. When we address, he said, bone of my bones, we are addressing chesed, which is the very depth of our body. Physically speaking, it's in relation, of course, with the bones, which is our spirit. But the bones are there, inside our flesh. And the flesh itself is geburah, the force that descends into malkut, make the body. We also read that Elohim planted Adam, that is Israel, and the sacred Garden of Eden, as it is written. And Yahweh Elohim took Ha-Adam and put him in the Garden of Eden. Genesis 2, verse 15. Yahweh Elohim, that is, the Heavenly Father and Mother. So you understand that the Heavenly Father and Mother, Yahweh Elohim, remember that Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh symbolizes phallus, uterus, or brain, uterus, man, woman. And that's Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. So when we read that Elohim planted Adam in the Garden of Eden, Eden means voluptuousness. When men and a woman are in the sexual act, they are in Eden. That's why the word Eden ends with nun, final nun. So, and he says, the Zohar said, that is Israel. Because Israel and Adam is the same. Garden means the lower Shekinah in Yesod, in Eden. The Heavenly Mother, Ha-Adam, the middle column of the Sephirotic tree from which was formed his wife, and who being his delight should never be separated from him. Here the Zohar is addressing the middle column. Right? He says that it is represented by the middle column. What is the middle column? It's Keter, Tifereth, Yesod, and Malkut. The straight. So Malkut is the wife. Because the brain is Adam, and the lower nature is below, which is Hava, Eve. Hava, remember, means life. Oh, this is Eve, the mother of the living, is what the Bible says. So, when we see the androgynous Adam, when the sexes are not separated, and then we see that the spinal medulla represents the positive and negative aspects of Adam, androgynous. This is how you have to see it. Man and wife together in one body. And we talked about that in the lectures related with the first, second, and third races before the division of sexes. It was then that the Holy One planted Israel, who are the holy branches of the world. Or in other words, a race purer and better than those that had formerly existed. As it is written, the branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified. Isaiah 60, 21. Of course, when you read that, it's a work of alchemy that Jehovah Elohim is doing with the two branches, Idap and Galah. Or the two valves, in other words, that we have in the spinal column. And out of the ground made Jehovah Elohim to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. Jehovah Elohim denoting the celestial father and mother. This is what the Zohar states. It's not like people think Jehovah Elohim, what we call Jehovah, God, is male. No. The word in itself denotes father and mother. Every tree that is pleasant to the sight, the just, and good for food. The one that are alchemically working. The just is not those that are faking to be good. just to be like Joseph, that defeated the temptation of the wife of that man in Egypt. I don't remember his name. He defeated because he was chaste. To be just is to be chaste. And obviously, when you are chaste, that tree is good for food. But you are fornicator, no, you are eating the forbidden fruit, which is the opposite. The middle column consisting of the Sephiroth, Keter, Tiferet, Yesod, and Malkut. We will say, well, that as well, which is in the throat, that you develop knowledge that you can communicate. And from which proceeds those stores of food by which the righteous are sustained, and which, when mankind becomes purified and enlightened, will contribute to the life of the world. Then will everyone take of the tree of life in the midst of the garden and eat and live forevermore. It says, when you know how to do the alchemical work. Because remember, your own particular Adam is in your spinal column. That's Adam created into the image of God, because has the light of the Kundalini, the light of the Shekinah. Because God created light. And God said, let there be light, means Vav Elohim, which is in the middle column, said, let there be light. For this way, you have to understand that there are three Vavs here. As we said it, the central, the right, and the left. The central Vav is, and Elohim said, or we will say it, Vav Elohim said. That Vav Elohim means the serpent in the middle, which is neutral and control the light, is the one that creates. But you have, that's why we always state, you have to awake the serpent of the middle in order to create. In order to create, in order to awake that serpent of the middle, you have to associate the two serpents, good and evil, odd and obd, in order to make or light. Here we have them. In the next graphic, look, the two serpents, and in the middle, the one, the letter Vav. That's why Master Jesus said, be wiser as serpents and meek as Jonah. Mean, perform the work that Jonah performed 3 days and three nights. It's not like people said, oh, I'm wiser now and very smart like a serpent. And I am meek, hypocritically acting. To be meek means to be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the big fish. That is to be a Jonah, a dove, alchemically speaking. That's why people that read that, they do not understand, and they think that the serpent is a symbol of evil. No. The serpent itself, symbol of evil, good, and life in the middle. It depends how we use the chayot. Remember, chayot means beasts, but also means lives in the feminine plural aspect. And these are the lives that we are talking about that we have in our spinal column. The three nervous systems, central nervous system, parasympathetic nervous system, and grand sympathetic nervous system. Those are the three serpents or energies that go everywhere in the body and that we need to control. Let us continue with the Zohar. because the Zohar brings light into the Bible. Otherwise, we just read stories and legends. It's literally written. Vav expel Yod at the man. Vav cast Yod the tabernacle of the east of the Garden of Eden, the cherubim and the flaming and the flame of the sword to invert herself over to keep at the way of the tree of life. This is what you read in Genesis 3:24. Alchemically speaking. If you don't know how to read alchemically, you said, and he expelled the man and put in the east of the Garden of Eden, cherubim and the flaming sword to guard the way of the tree of life. It's how you read it. Many translations. But alchemically is how you read it. We are reading here. Vav expel Yod. It's how it's written alchemically. Which Vav is talking about? The left. Because that left is the one that goes to Malkut and down to Klipoth. When you reach the orgasm, the spasm of animals, Chayot, then the forces of your brain, the Yod, which is the man, are expelled out of your system. So Vav, the serpent that enjoys the bestial sexual act with orgasm, cause the tabernacle of the east, which is Tifereth, and the flaming sword, which isn't a spinal column that gives life and gives power, that's the sword, from Yesod to Keter, that goes, the flame, when you are chased. But when you fornicate and you expel that Yod, which is also at the word, Alpha and Omega, beginning and ending, is also expelled. So therefore, everything becomes inverted. The fire goes down into Klipoth and to the fornicators, that at, which is the power of the word, remains guarded by their own passion. Because then that flame that was giving you light, understanding and wisdom and your spinal medulla and your David, which means your internal boiler, the medulla, obviously go down and becomes a passional fire that in Sanskrit is called kundabhafer, desire. And that passion, when you are in a sexual act, is precisely what keep at the word out of the tree of life. The tree of life is your spinal column. If that at penetrates in the spinal column, then the light will emerge with knowledge of good and evil. But when man and woman are in a sexual act, that sword that was going up in the beginning in the chaste person is now going down, making the tail of Satan, which is passion, in the sexual act. And that turns every way in your body, in your system, and you feel the fire. And the man and the woman cannot control and reach the orgasm of the beasts. And therefore, at is kept out of the tree of life, the spinal column. If you control that fire, then at Alpha and Omega, Christ, in other words, penetrates as fire and goes up again in the medulla. And then you said, oh, I am becoming wise as serpent. But I want to be and should be meek as Jonah. I had to perform the 3 days. It's not just doing that, you know? It's not just doing the transmutation of alchemy. You have to do this because the Lord Jesus says, be wiser as serpents and meek as Jonah. Because as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, the Son of Man should be also there working. 3 days are three alchemical steps. There are no days of 24 hours. It's alchemical time. That's why, you know, the Zohar says, do we know who expelled who? Or who it is was at which was expelled, whether the third Logos, the Holy Spirit, or not? Of course, who is the Holy Spirit, which is called Asher. When Moses was front of God, and he says, Eheye, Asher, Eheye. I am who is. I am who. And Asher is who. So when you read there, who in Zohar, who is the one that was expelled? Of course, the very essence of God in Yesod, sex. Which is at the word Alpha and Omega, Christ. Out. And who spell it? The word are va'ai garesh at. Vav yod expel at. Who was this yod? Who was this yod? The scripture says ha adam, the man, the brain. When you are in a sexual act and you expel yod at through your sexual act, the one that is punished is your brain. Anyone that is studying this day and age endocrinology knows very well that the sexual hormones nourished the brain and the pineal gland. That's why the more you transmute the sexual energy, the more wiser you come. Your pineal gland becomes active and your brain active too. But if you masturbate, you degenerate your brain. The punishment of masturbation is idiocy that you yourself create in your brain. Nobody is doing it for you, you yourself. Because you are prostituting your own Elohim. When you are committing adultery, you're doing the same. It's nobody outside that is going to punish you, because that energy comes inside and it is up to you what you do with it. It's not a matter of believing. It's a matter of doing. Asya, matter in action. Therefore, scripture first informs us that the Lord God, Yod Havah Elohim Bina, expelled Adam from out of that, the upper garden of Eden. Here, the union of the brain with the three logoic forces that we explain, that is ion or ion, is the spinal column. When the man fornicated, obviously the forces up eject the soul out of that union, as the Book of Zohar explains. Through the valve of the central column of the tree of life, as Adam, the brain, had already expelled here below through his yod sexual organ in the lower garden of Eden, Yesod, the at, the word, the third logos, the Holy Spirit, or substance, Christ, contained within the final noon of Eden, when the upper Eden became close to him and the path leading to it obliterated or hidden. So in other words, Were we expelled? We expel ourselves, and we continue expelling ourselves. It's not that God did it. Get out of here because you didn't obey my commandments. Your God is inside. And if you do that, you are expelled by your own actions. That's why I said, who expelled who? You know? God expelled, yeah, but before we were expelling him. Because God is a sexual force, is a creative force. If we expel God out, and he says, okay, you are expelling me, I expel you too. If you obey me, accept me, I welcome you. It's just two wills here. Two wills. Right? So, don't blame God of your misery. Blame you, because you are doing it. And that's why we are teaching here. You obey, God will bless you. That blessing comes from inside. It's not a God outside. It's the God that is within you. That is the Holy Spirit, the creative energy. Elohim. That's why you find that God is called in synthesis, Jah. And we call Hallelujah. That Yah is Yod-Heh. Father, Mother, Hallelujah, praise Yah, Father, Mother. And where this Yah is formed or united, Father, Mother, in that, in this area of the throat, is where God, El, and Ella, Goddess, is united and receive the forces of the waters in order to develop knowledge. Because Da'at means knowledge, Gnosis. So when the spinal column is united with Da'at, behold Adam, united with father and mother. The next graphic we see Hermes again. We're associating this with Hermes, because remember that Hermes is associated with the word, with wisdom. Mercury, which you look at the sun, Mercury is rotating, the first planet that is rotating close to the sun. It's so close to the sun that many great masters says, Mercury and the sun are one, the word. And this is what you have to comprehend and analyze when you study alchemy. Hermes Trismegistus, represented here, of course, the caduceus of Mercury and the two serpents, and he in the middle with entwined but one serpent. That is one that becomes wiser as serpents. So, Vav, the left serpent, caused the tabernacle from Tifereth, the east of Da'at, the upper garden of Eden, which is at the two cherubim of Yesod, the lower Eden, and at the flame of the sword to be inverted towards Klipoth, in order to keep at the way of the tree of lives. So, in other words, we live in Klipoth. Kipoth is hell, in other words, Kabbalistically speaking. People in this day and age are afraid of doing bad things, because if they do bad things, they go to hell. But here in this Gnostic classroom, we say, we are already in hell. We have to stop doing evil things, which is related with Ida, in order to be out of Kipoth. Out of hell. If we don't do that, then we will sink more into the inner layers of Klipoth, the other shells. That's why we read in Revelation, I am the Logos, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, says the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty, El Shaddai, in Yesod. And when I saw him, I fell in Malkut, at his feet as dead. And he lays his right hand upon me, the positive force of Pingala, saying unto me, fear not, I am at the first and the last letters of the Hebrew alphabet. I am he that lives and was dead by the fornicator Amalekites. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. This is what the book of Revelation states. If you are an alchemist, you know what you're reading. And you know that that Lord is in the spinal column. He has the keys of hell and of death. Of course, he already conquered the left side. He had to do it. We had to do his will with our will together in order to defeat the negative aspect in us. Let us continue studying the Zohar in order to go deeper into this. Because when you people read this in the Zohar, I wonder if they understand what they're reading. Hear what the scripture says when Adam and Eve ate of the fruit of the tree by which death entered into nefesh, their souls or lower nature. And when they heard the voice of the Lord of the Elohim walking in the garden, or as it's odd to be rendered, had walked in the garden, you had to wonder, who is this Elohim? You see, the Lord of the Elohim, wrote the writers of Zohar. In another lecture, we stated, when the souls of the animal kingdom are ready to enter into the humanoid kingdom, in the time of Lemuria, those lemurs that were androgynous and united with their being, started giving them physical bodies to those souls of the animal kingdom that were already evolved to enter into that level. So obviously, when you receive a body of that nature, that body is connected to the Elohim, because all of them were bodhisattvas of perfection. When you, for instance, become a child of a great master, your body is connected to the Elohim of that master because the sperm of that master is chaste. And through that master, you can, if you follow his directions, to become perfect. But when the humans were divided into sexes, as you know, they committed fornication. They ate of the fruit that was commanded by the Elohim. Don't eat. I will give you my body. I will give you a body as an inheritance. But I am a chaste person. You are coming from the animal kingdom. Follow this. You shall not eat of this fruit, which is sex. Because the day that you eat from it, you will die. You will not enter into the tree of life. So, the souls of the animal kingdom that entered there, who were obeying, they of course were entering into the tree of life. But if they were following their instincts by the tempting serpent, who is the left side, they fell into their temptation and lost that purity. Note further that whilst Adam had not fallen, he was a recipient of divine wisdom, Chokhmah, and heavenly light, and derived his continuous existence from the tree of life to which he had free access. But as soon as he allowed himself to be seduced and deluded with the desire of occult knowledge, he lost everything, heavenly light and life, through the disjunction of his higher and lower self. and the loss of that harmony that should always exist between them. In short, he then first knew what evil was and what it entailed. And therefore it is written, "Thou art not a God that approveth wickedness, neither shall evil dwell within thee." Or in other words, he who implicitly and blindly follows the dictates of his lower nature or self shall not come near to the tree of life. In other words, he who follows the sensation orgasm and like the bestiality, he will never eat from the tree of life, from the fruits of the tree of life, the spinal column, because he is ejecting the only force that allowed him to enter in. Whilst the protoplasts had not as yet lost their innocence and purity, they heard within themselves the voice divine, the voice out of the great silence, guided and directed by divine wisdom. They walked and lived in the divine light and were not afraid. As soon, however, as they succumbed to temptation, they lapsed into a state of sin, of sorrow and shame, and found that, though the voice was still audible, they could not endure to hear it, and the sense of sin pervaded and prevailed throughout the world up to the time when Israel, Tifereth, stood at the foot, Yesod, on Mount Sinai, purified from all defilement, and thus able to become conjoined with the tree of life, and partook of its fruits, beholding the celestial glory. They ascended higher and higher in the divine life and lived in the enjoyment of the beatific vision, being filled with that interior peace and tranquility known as and experienced only by those who understand the mystery of the higher and divine life. Here the Zohar is associating the fall of Adam and Eve with what happened in Exodus, because it's the same. First, Moses explained that very cryptically and alchemically in Genesis. And then in the book of Exodus, he explains the way how we can go out. But there were many that, even though they were doing the work, they fell again into sin. And they lost that purity. In other words, the initiate enters into the path. And first is having a lot of experiences, seeing things in the internal planes, communication with their God. But if they are not aware of their ego, and they don't defeat that negative serpent that is called Kundalini, because when Ida descends through fornication down into hell, we develop the Kundalini organ, the tail of Satan. And we had to work against it. There are many elements that we have to defeat. If we don't do it, then of course we lose that enlightenment that we are receiving through the alchemical work that we are doing. Because remember that if we defeat temptation, then we enter into the tree of life and live forever. And that's precisely the goal. But the whole work is a great work of transformation, meditation, comprehension that we have to do of ourselves. With patience, you will possess your souls. And little by little, we are gathering Israel with the will power that we call Moses. And we advance. But all the people of opposition that want to avoid us to enter into the higher levels of the tree of life are inside of us. They are not outside. If we don't defeat them inside, we cannot defeat them outside. Behold here the symbolism of the tree of life in the next graphic. When we work here in Malkut, which is the world of Asya, matter in action, and we rise that forces to the heart or beyond in the center column of the tree of life, and then we perform what is in the right side, the Star of David, with Malkut in the middle. When Malkut is in the middle, like this, of the Star of David, and then we acquire immortality, and we live forever, because we have placed all the lower forces up. As you see here, Malkut and Yesod are up, above Geburah and Hesed. Transmutation. We have purified ourselves. Then we acquire immortality. That is not because somebody is doing this and already had conquered the physicality and know how to transmute the sexual energy that he's going to be immortal. No. Immortality demands, first, chastity. Second, complete annihilation of bestiality. Lust, anger, greed, envy, gluttony, laziness, pride, etc. And this is how above us is Keter Chokhmah Binah, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That is the symbol of the true human being. And as you see here, you find this letters, Yod He, Vav He, the holy name of God. Yod, the brain, Vav, the spinal column, and He, why? Because the letter He symbolizes the head and the spinal column here, you see. And a letter Vav separated from it. That means that the letter He, that is the feminine aspect, is showing us that the feminine comes from the masculine. But the letter Vav in the middle is showing us that is the left rib, the left side that is polarized in the man positively, and in the woman negatively. That's He. Above, Yod He represents the father and mother. And Vav represents the spinal medulla, Adam, and He represents the wife. In this case, our own physicality. Our own physicality is He. Vav is the spinal medulla. And above, in that, is Yod He, father, mother. This is how we are when we are working, single, or when Adam was androgynous. But remember, it's written, Adam in the middle. We leave his father and mother and will unite to his wife. Now you ask, how does Adam in the middle, which is the middle column, will abandon Yod-He, father, mother, and be one flesh with his wife? How? Because when the division of sexes happen, then Adam, which is androgynous, becomes Pingala, the solar force or positive force. And the wife becomes Hara, Eve, Ida. So that's why it is written, Adam will live. This androgenism that is in the spinal medulla will live. Father and mother goes to the right. And then we said, now in order to go with my father and mother, I have to unite to my wife, the left side. And being united in the left side, I become like my father and mother with wisdom. Jehovah Elohim. This is how you study it and how you understand, alchemically speaking. Because literally speaking, people think that the man will leave his father and physical mother and make a new home with his wife. Because they will make sex and have one flesh. And literally seen in that way, of course, you see it. But it's not like that. Your head is Adam. Vav, the heart, Tifereth, is also Adam. And the power of Adam is in Yesod, which is another Vav. This is how you see it. Or Yod, Vav, final Nun. The three primary forces in those letters. And when you want to improve, you want to advance in your development of that spinal medulla, and then you leave the middle column, which is controlled by father and mother, and become Pingala. This is, now I am Pingala, which I am the sun, I need the moon, which is Eve. United with him, I become one flesh. And becomes to work with the middle column again. This is how you understand that statement written in the Bible. Let us continue what the Zohar states. The Holy One protected them by impressing upon them his divine name, so that the spirit of evil was unable to exercise power and influence over them and thus corrupt them. Thus, they lived pure and protected until they bowed down and worshipped the golden calf, the materialistic forces of Malkut. Then fell they from their high estate and lost the divine protection, which was as cuirass, or protective armor, against the assaults of evil, that now again acquired power over them and brought death unto their souls. You see the graphic there of Hermes again, protected by the two forces of father and mother that we are talking about. In the vital body, that is the superior part of the physical body, we developed, when we are in chastity, a cuirass, or armor, that in the resurrected master gives them access to 1,000, at least 1,000 years of life, physically speaking. So any master that enters into resurrection acquires that immortality thanks to that special protection that is given by the father mother to his vital body. This is how you acquire immortality. People, when they enter into these studies, they think that because they are starting practicing sexual magic, oh, they are immortal and they will not die. No, they will die. If you want to resurrect, you have to die if you take that path. And if you acquire the 3 days and three nights of Jonah, the dove, if you are a wiser serpent, then in the resurrection, you acquire immortality at least 1,000 years. And every 1,000 years, you ask to your father and mother for more protection. And like that, you find masters that have millions of years living with the same physicality. But they are resurrected masters. Most of the masters that appear and teach, like in this case, in Gnosis, in this Gnostic doctrine in this day and age, The only master that acquired that in 1977 was Master Samaelon Deor. He acquired that protection again in his vital body. Now the body that he has is immortal. The body that he had is disintegrated completely because it was a body of sin, as our body. The people don't understand that. How come the Master Samaelon Deor gets sick? He was a master. He was not a resurrected master. I personally asked a question to him. Master, I was teaching there in the north of Mexico in 1976, I believe. I don't remember well. And we were making collections, collecting money in order to pay his ticket. As a master, we collected your ticket. Here with the brothers, and I said, well, he says, I don't travel alone. I always travel with the Master Atlantis. Oh, okay, I understand. So I need a ticket also for the Master Atlantis. And I said, okay. I said, now we collected more money. And we finally brought them here, to north of Mexico, in order to teach. At that time, he was very active. There, I took the opportunity and ask him, Master, why is this trouble always without the missionaries here collecting money and asking for money in order for you to come here in an airplane, which I understand because by land is very tiring. Why don't you come in Jin Estate? Your wife taught you Jin Estate. So both of you are skillful in that. Come here and teach and leave. And then we don't collect money. And then he says, wow, a master that does that is a resurrected master. I am not a resurrected master yet. Next year, I will reach that level. But right now, Master Atlantis and I, we need to travel in an airplane. I am not, he says, Saint Germain. Or Faust, like he can do it, because they are resurrected. But I'm in process. Yeah, I understand, Only a resurrected master can do that. Can appear here, disappear there. But we are following the rules of Jin Estate. If we enter here in the fourth dimension, in order to get out, we have to get out here, in the same place where we entered. That's a law. A resurrected master is a master that controls that law. So therefore, you see, now that those masters have that protective armor in their vitality, their physical body is always the same youth, same age, immortal. But we get old. We die. Unless we acquire immortality, but that's a great work to collect all the parts of Israel in us in order to rise the second mountain. That's not a matter of blowing glass and making bottles. It's what the Master Samael says. Let us continue the Zohar. Because this is special for those people that like and follow the word of the Bible. After their fall, Scripture informs us, and when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, his face shone radiant with light, and they were afraid to come nigh unto him. Before this, however, it is written, and Israel saw the mighty hand of the Lord, that is, they were able, by the purification of the lower nature and mental and spiritual illumination, to attain unto the beatific vision and view the splendor and glory of the life of high. And so it is further written, and the people saw the thunderings and lightnings and the sound of the trumpet. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 13. It is not like people think Oh, that they were coming from Egypt and going into Israel in the Middle East, and people were seeing all of that. This is alchemy. This is Kabbalah. Something related with the initiation. And it's written in that way in order to mislead those fornicators that go on and think that, oh, they're talking about us. Because every group here in Judaism, in Christianity, in Islam, they always claiming that they are the people of Israel. And that God is preparing something special for them because they believe in that. No, the people of Israel are all the archetypes that we have within. And that's it. If we want to work with those archetypes, then we will enter into the Exodus. The Exodus is not a matter of following this group or following this other group. The Exodus is inside. Alchemical work that we have to perform with Israel. But first, Moses has to appear. Because without Moses, how are we going to collect Israel? Somebody appears there saying, oh, I am Moses, the Bodhisattva of Moses. Follow me. I am going to collect all of those parts. No, no, no. Moses is with power that we have to develop inside. It's a causal body. We develop the causal body, and when that will of God in us, then we collect all the parts of Israel which are lost in Egypt. But don't be afraid of the light of Moses, because that is his light. The Zohar explains all the mysteries of the Bible like that. The people see that light, they say, oh, this is too much work. I thought I only believing in Jesus we were going to be saved. No, it's not like that. It's by following the law. Remark now what is further stated. And the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments by the Mount Orev. Orev have the meaning of Sinai, by which is signified that Israel, Tifereth, after sinning, became divested of their safeguards, the ornaments of purity and integrity, and thus fell under the power of evil. So that, as it is stated, Moses was compelled to take the tabernacle and set it up away without the camp and call it the tabernacle of the congregation. Exodus 33:7. For what reason? This is how it's finished, you know. For what reason? When you read it, for what reason? Oh, he's asking, what was the reason? No, no. For what? What reason? What is Ma in Hebrew? Because Ma, they prostituted Ma, the mother, which is a sexual force. That was the reason. For what? You see? Who, in the pineal gland, saw that what? His wife was prostituted by Israel. The heart. That's why in Samuel 2, chapter 6 and 2, we read alchemically. Vav arose. David's Vav walked. All people's Vav who were with him from Baale, Judah, they brought up thence the shrine of the Elohim, Asher. The forces of Asher, they brought it up to their head through Vav. Asher is the name that has been given to the name of Jehovah Sabaoth, inhabiting upon the cherubim, precisely in their pineal gland. This is how you read alchemically that statement. People, when read that, they imagine, for instance, that a group of people take the shrine or the Ark of the Covenant and go up to a certain place with David. David means boiler. When in the sexual act you are boiling with fire, your spinal medulla is the boiler. And the Vav is the spinal medulla. So that is, as this, Vav Aros. the serpent that was fallen arose. Now it's in chastity. Vav walked. The energy of the Kundalini rose, walked little by little through the spinal column of all the peoples, Vav, who were with him. With that alchemical statement, with David, with the boiler, doing that alchemical work. From Baal of Judah, the forces of Yesod, they brought up thence the shrine of the Elohim Asher. To bring up that shrine, that ark, is to sublimate the energy up to the brain. And this is precisely the tabernacle. That is a name given to Yod-Havah-Savaot. Who is Yod-Havah-Savaot? If you know Kabbalah, Yod-Havah-Savaot is Netzach. Netzach is the mind. Yod-Havah-Savaot is in the brain. In the pineal gland, he is the Lord of hosts. Because Netzach is in the head, Hod is in the heart, and Yesod is in the sex. This is how you see it. And he is precisely upon the cherubim. And who are the cherubim? The man and the woman that do in alchemy, sexual transmutation, that are chaste in the sexual act. Those are representation of the cherubim. Only between the cherubim, you can see the ark of the covenant, and they open the way to the tree of life, which is your spinal medulla. Do you have questions?
So, a ways back, one of those quotes from the Zohar that you read associated the phrase, "and good for food," with particularly the middle column of the tree of life. Keter, Tiferet, and Yesod. Why are these good for food, but not the left and the right columns?
Because the middle column relates to the positive and negative forces of the androgynism in the middle. The brain, or we will say it, to the three aspects of the Logos, the Father in the brain, the Son in Tifereth, and Yesod, the Holy Spirit, and Malkut, your body. So when you are centered in your spinal column, you are eating the fruits, which are, of course, the seven chakras, or the seven churches that the Book of Revelations talks about, plus the five senses, because they are united. Remember that the five senses are united to the central nervous system and also to the other nervous systems that we have. And those are the fruits that you develop, perfect, and then you see things with the light. You are not only seeing things physically, but things beyond the physical plane, because you are in the middle. You are eating from the fruits. And of course, remember that the middle column is fed by Pingala and Ida, because the only way to awake that light in the middle is by performing sexual alchemy. As when you are single, when you are working in yourself, and then you have that enjoyment of eating the tree of life because you are in chastity. Let's say celibacy, but not an ordinary celibacy. You transmute your sexual energy and you are celibate. Right? And you are developing certain degree, we will say, of the tree of life because you are chaste. But then, every time if you marry, every time that you perform the sexual act, you automatically withdraw from the central column and becomes Pingala, and takes your wife and become one flesh. And then the light of your middle column, as well of your wife, becomes more enlightened, more with more energy. So then you are enjoying the fruits of the tree of life. You are eating it and you are enjoying and developing knowledge. But in one time, you unite with your wife and you reach the orgasm, and then the light descends from the center. That's why Jehovah Elohim said, from the fruit, which is the sperm of the ovum, the light which is in the sexual organs, you shall not eat from that fruit. The day that you eat, you will die. Death is the opposite of life. Your spinal column is the tree of life. Death is klipoth. Then you enter into the world of klipoth and you are dead. That's why you shouldn't eat, right? From the tree of good and evil. But the only way that you can eat from that tree is when you perform the sexual act. Because good is pingala and evil is ida. Or moon and sun, right? United in order to make light. And the evening and the morning, one day. And the evening and the morning, and the man and the woman, in other words, another day, another initiation, and like that. It's how you advance. And this is the knowledge that was given to the monads of the animal kingdom that were entering the human kingdom in the time of Lemuria. If you do this, you will enjoy. But if you perform the sexual act as you were doing it in your animal level, you won't advance. You will become inhabitants of Klipoth. When the Lemurians knew that, they wanted to kill themselves. Because this is the difficult. We'll avoid. This is all the path that all the monads always pass from the animal kingdom into the human kingdom. Another question? Yeah.
So the Lemurians were androgynous, and then the animals were both male and female. When you take the path, when a master finishes the path and becomes a resurrected master and embodies the Christic spirit, they become androgynous again. Does that happen within themselves? Do they merge, or if they're one sex or another sex, do they merge with another, or what? How does that?
When the master acquire immortality or resurrection, you mean in a male or female body? That's your question, right? Well, it depends in which body are you doing the work. If you are doing the work with a male body, you're acquiring immortality with that male body, but your male body in the resurrection is not a male body, but an androgynous body with two polarities, but is more shown to the masculine aspect, right? And internally, you are androgynous, but physically, you are male because you are acquiring immortality as male. And if you do it as a female, and then you become an immortal master with a female body. Like Joan of Arc, for instance, is an immortal female master, right, that acquires immortality. And most of the masters that we know are always masculine. But there are a lot of feminine masters, immortal, that we don't know. Because you can acquire immortality in either body. Yes?
So I can't pronounce that word.
Androgynous.
When they split, it didn't happen physically, right? They didn't become two people.
They just... They happen physically. But it happens, of course, through the centers.
So is there such thing as two people connected to the same monad?
What happened is this. In the beginning, the protoplasmic, hyperborean, and Lemurian root races of the past were androgynous, meaning that their bodies were having masculine and feminine in themselves. Andros is man. Genika is woman in Greek. So when you said androgenika, androgynous, you are pointing men and male and female in the same body. So all of these individuals who were androgynous, they were masters, authentic human beings. But they were, according to evolution, they were reaching the level in which the monads that were coming from the animal kingdom should enter into the humanoid kingdom in order to acquire that human level. And the only way to enter there is by receiving bodies from these androgynous. So these androgynous became divided, as the Bible explains. Eve was taken out of Adam, so we're divided in two sexes. Because in order to acquire the immortal androgynism, you had to do it through the sexual act. You cannot do it by inheriting an androgynous body. That would be good, right? Marvelous. Oh, androgynous body, it worked there. No. You have to fight, you see? And that's why they separated. And when they separated, they were leaving their bodies to the monads of the animal kingdom, which were already divided. According to the Bible, the animals were divided first. And then the humans. So they were already knew about division. So then when they received a female or a male body, they already knew, oh, this is what I had in the animal kingdom. Now it's human, but I have to learn not to reach the orgasm in order to reach the human level. Some of them says, so difficult. And as you see, they ate of the fruit. And they lost the opportunity. But there were also other humans at that level that also took advantage of the situation and they fell. This is what they call the fallen angels. It's another story. It's with a mixture. This is what the Bible called Amalekites. That knew about that and were masters and they fell. And they fornicated with the daughters of Adam, which means they were already divided in sexes. But after that, of course, by knowing evil through fornication, then those animal souls enter again into the path and acquire mastery. That's Seth, the third child of Adam and Eve, explained in the Bible. But understand that everything that is written there is in relation with your spinal column. Understand that the word Elohim means El and Ella, God and Goddess. In the sea, the yam, the waters that you have in your cerebral spinal fluid and your sexual fluid. That is Elohim in you. That is what we call gods. It's a plural name. It's not singular. And for that, you have to understand that the brain is masculine and the sex is feminine. This is why it is written that when Adam and Eve united like that, it says, because the one that said that was Adam. Adam said, it's written, this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. And then he continues saying, thus, Adam will leave father and mother and connect to his wife, and there will be one flesh. When he said that, the Zohar states, he said that to Eve. And Eve said, oh yeah? Yeah. We had to be one flesh in order to continue the work. And when they were united sexually, and then the snake that is related with a sexual act, which is Ida, because Ida is connected to the sexual lower force of Yesod, phallus and uterus, or vagina. When they were united, and they were feeling that delicious sensation of the sexual act, and then the serpent was wiser, that Baal talked to Eve. Oh, what is what Jehovah Elohim in your spinal column told you? That we shouldn't eat of this fruit in a very sexual act. Oh, you won't die. You won't die. Eat. You know, but the serpent was outside. It was inside of them. It was Ida in both sexes, which is feminine. That's why it says that tempted Eve. But Eve is not the brain. Eve is the sex. Because who created you in her womb? Adam or Eve? It was Eve. You were in the womb of your mother 9 months. So Eve works here. And everybody knows that. But Adam is the brain. So that's why it is stated that in the sexual act, Var, the serpent, tempt Eve. But they were tempted in the sexual act. Eat of the fruit. You will not die. On the contrary, your eyes were open. And you will see what is good and evil. And they did it. Eve took the serpent, reached the orgasm, and immediately the brain received the information. Oh, this is nice. Adam is also testing the fruit, but the one that tastes the fruit first is the sexual organ, Eve. So therefore, they were naked. They said, oh, we are stupid. We didn't know about this. And then they saw themselves that they were naked. Before they were naked, I mean ignorant. But they didn't know. But now that they ate of the fruit, they know, oh, this is signs of evil. But this is bad. And then when the inner God inside of their spinal medulla was looking for them, where are you? Where are you? And then you were, as Zohar says, you were hiding yourself from that. Do you eat for the fruit that I told you do not eat? Of course. God knows very well in your spinal column what you did. And then you read the rest, that damnation and all that, that has happened to each one of us because of our disobedience. But if we obey now, we will enter again into the path and eat of the fruit of the tree of life and live forever more. You have another question? Yeah? Let's see if I can explain that in short in order for you, because I understand your question. If you observed the graphic that we have here, when we see the symbol of Adam and Eve, you see, below this iron, which is, as you know, positive or negative charge atoms, men and women, in other words. You see here, Adam represents the brain, and Eve represents the feminine organ. Adam represents the masculine current called Pingala, and Eve represents the feminine current known Ida, as Ida. And separated them, Adam is the male and Eve is the female. So in alchemy, you have to understand all those aspects of Adam and Eve, alchemically speaking, in order to understand what you read in the Bible. Because I am Adam, I am polarized positively, an iron, charged positively. But my wife is Eve, charged, an iron, charged negatively. Right? So I have to unite with her in order to make a neutral force, which is my spinal column. There is no other way to awake the Kundalini, or what we call at the word Christ in ourselves. As a single person, we unite Ida and Pingala, because we have there Adam and Eve, the two polarities, separated in us, right? Everybody has it, a woman or a man. And with that we work, and we develop at a certain level. Beyond that, we need the polarity of the woman in order to continue. Otherwise, it's impossible. Because for the light of the middle column to awake, we need the cooperation of the negative iron, which is the woman. Otherwise, there is no polarization there. It's impossible. Those people that state that you can reach self-realization just with your body that you have, they ignore the laws of alchemy. It's impossible. Because the tree of life, which is here, is nourished with the tree of good and evil, which is Yasad. So you have to unite in order to rise. Single, yeah, you can start, because many of the initiates that start in this path always start as single, doing exercises of pranayama in advance at a certain level. But beyond that, you have to unite with your nun. You see that the word N-U-N, nun, nun, but final nun. You see? It's final nun. Because the final nun is the nun, there's a big fish that goes from the Yasad up to the brain. That's the big fish that rises, or the energy of the Holy Spirit that rises from the bottom to the top of your brain when you are sexually united. And then you are being meek as Jonah. You see that statement? Be wiser as serpents. And so what is he talking about? Wiser as serpents. Well, I had three serpents. Ida, Pingala, and in the middle is the Shushumna. Those are the three serpents of the Caduceus of Mercury. I have to be wise as serpents. I have to work with the serpents in my spinal column. But I had to be meek as Jonah, meaning a chaste. Because in order to enter into the big fish, you have to be in chastity. It is easy, very easy, to do the work as a single person at a certain level. Initiations of minor mysteries is easy. But to do the same work, continue the work in the sexual act, it is not easy. It's very difficult. Because there appears always your best friend, Lucifer. Ah! So Jehovah Elohim told you that? And every time that you perform the sexual act, he's there, pushing you to reach the orgasm. That's why it's rare to find niches of major mysteries. Because Lucifer always wins. And he goes up to Jehovah Elohim and says, what do you see, this initiate? Oh, yeah. He's just blah, 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 blah. In the very sexual act, I'm tempting him, and he is, you know, he just reached the orgasm. He didn't enter into the whale. He is just a demon with the face of a crocodile. Another question? Yep.
So as a male, the point of uniting with a female in my work in doing that is to not expel semen. Yeah.
It's not just that. Is it not to reach the orgasm or the spasm? That is, and for that you have to sublimate your energy. You have to learn that. It's just not that avoiding the orgasm. That's, many people do that in order to prolong the sexual act. But this is how to sublimate, how to learn alchemy in order to transmute the sexual energy and sublimate the energy. Remember, the big fish is the final noon. Has to go from the bottom to the brain, up. And that is to enter into the belly of the big fish.
So as a male, when I'm about to reach orgasm, I basically mentally pull that energy out of my sexual organs, up to the colon and in the brain. Yeah, I circulate this.
Well, in certain, it's impossible to give the details here about how to do sexual alchemy. But let me tell you, Master Samael Onveo wrote a book about it, and it's called The Perfect Matrimony. And he indicates there the process of doing it. And also he wrote another book called The Mystery of the Golden Blossom, and where he describes as well all details, and many of his books. But these two books, because in order to learn how to do that, it's not just doing sex and avoiding the spasm. It's not just that. You have to learn, because you have to give your life, your soul, your spirit to your inner God that dwells in your spinal column, and to pray to that in order to acquire that ability. Because remember that the book of Genesis says, Vav Elohim said, it's not you, it's Elohim inside of you that will do it if you align your willpower with his willpower, or with both willpowers above and below.
Last tiny yes and no question. In this process of transmutation, there are three steps which are called the 3 days of Jonah, or is that a different thing?
Yeah, the 3 days of Jonah are three steps
within
the whole work that we have to perform. First day of Jonah is to do in the sexual act to create astral solar body, mental solar body, causal solar body. That is the first day. Second day, to annihilate all your egos in your physicality, all those egos that you see clearly in yourself until you became chaste in the physical plane. And then you acquire the second day. That is the second. The third day is the most difficult, because you have to penetrate in your subconsciousness and to clean completely all of them and then to resurrect. For that, you have to go into Klipoth. All the subconsciousness, unconsciousness, infraconsciousness, and annihilate all the egos of lust, all the egos of anger, all the egos of gluttony, laziness, and all that we have in abundance. And by doing that, you are liberating Israel from slavery. And you are gathering all of that in order to return to Sinai, which is the higher levels, and to acquire resurrection. That's the, in synthesis, we will say, the 3 days of Jonah.
So you began the lecture by talking about two serpents that swim in the waters, Ida and Pingala, and their corrupting influence on the man. And we talked in the lecture about the serpent, primarily about the corrupting influence of the serpent that swims from the left,
yeah.
Ida, and how through this serpent Eve corrupts the brain through the loss of the sexual energy. But we didn't talk much about the corrupting influence of the serpent that swims from the right, Pingala. Is this related to the corrupting influence that the brain has on the sex? How lust can cause the sex to can cause Eve to lose the energy? Is that what that serpent represents?
More or less, when Ida, the left serpent, corrupted the brain, which is Adam. Adam became corrupted. So that serpent called Pingala became also corrupted.
And then therefore...
So therefore, that therefore Pingala, or that serpent related with the brain, which is Adam, overstates. This doesn't convince me. I think that God gave us this instance, natural sexual instance, in order to enjoy it. That's your mind, your brain, your Adam, justifying your corruption. That's the problem. That's why Zohar says, these two serpents are the enemies of the middle column, which is Adam, right? Pingala, which is in relation with your thoughts, your brain, is always corrupting. This humanity is corrupted with the brain, intellectual. And this humanity gives the interpretation of these alchemical statements of Moses according to their whim. Enter into our group and you will saved, or you will be saved, right? Follow us. If we start doing that, then we will lie. Nobody can save you but yourself. And of course, those forces that you call Christ, Jehovah, Holy Spirit, are inside of you. They are not outside. They are inside. If they are not doing anything because you don't work with them, right? And you have to start doing that. But then you have to learn first, as Master Paracelsus says, first learn the science of alchemy, and then practice it. That we are giving these lectures in relation with the Zohar, and sometimes are very cryptic. But we do it in order for the people to see that we are not making up this. It's written in the Zohar, which is the spirit of the doctrine, based on that, the Bible is written. But if you read the Bible without knowing the Zohar, you won't understand. And in order to understand the Zohar, you have to do a practical alchemist and Kabbalist. It's not just about theory, because there's a lot of people there that read the Zohar. Another lecture I told you, I met in Canada this friend of mine that told me, every time Saturday, because he was an Orthodox Jew, every time that I stood the Zohar with my friends on Saturday, we turn off the lights, and we really concentrate and smoke marijuana in order to understand what is written. Oh, this is how you study the Zohar. And he was an Orthodox Jew. And I was looking at him, and I was really surprised. What? You smoke marijuana in order to understand? What the heck are you doing? Oh, you don't know. You don't know because you are not in a group, he says. And what we do. I said, okay, keep doing it. Maybe one day you will discover the mysteries of the Zohar. Thank you very much.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy.